You know that electricity reaches your homes from the station through wires. Now, due to this electricity that reaches your homes, you are able to run several appliances like tube lights, bulbs, TVs, etc. Now, often what happens is this electricity fails. That is, load shedding takes place, or which is also known as a power cut. So due to this load shedding or power cut, what happens is you don't get electricity at your homes and no appliance works. So under such circumstances, you must have been familiar with the use of a torch. A torch is an instrument that provides us with light whenever there is a failure of electricity. So if there is no electricity all around, where do you think a torch is getting its light from? How do you think that the bulb that is inside the torch is able to provide us with light? Well, we shall find that out very soon. The torch is able to provide us with light because it contains a battery or a cell. The work of this cell is used to provide electricity to the bulb of this torch, and thereby the bulb is able to give out light, which we use in terms of load shedding. In this picture, you will find two different kinds of batteries have been shown. The first kind is a regular kind of battery, and the second kind, that is the big one, is a car battery. A car battery gives power to a car. So how do you think a battery actually functions? Does a battery create the charge and then cause it to flow inside the bulb? Let us see the principle of working of a battery. For this, we need to revisit some old concepts. Do you remember what potential difference was? Potential difference was created when there was an excess of negative charge on one end and an excess of positive charge on the other end. So whenever we had a positively charged body and a negatively charged body, there was a potential difference that was created. And this enabled electrons to flow from the negative body to the positive body, and conventional current, or simply current, flowed from the positive body to the negative body. So the work of a battery or a cell is also similar. What the battery does is, it creates a potential difference. That is, when connected across a circuit, a battery creates a potential difference. It does not create the charge. So when the battery creates the potential difference, it causes the charge inside the wires and the circuit to flow, and this is how the current flows in the circuit. So when we are considering a case for a torch, when a battery is placed inside a torch, as you will find if you open the torch, the work of this battery is merely to create a potential difference. Due to the creation of this potential difference, the charges that already exist flow around the circuit, and thus we are able to get light from the torch or the bulb of the torch. So this is quite similar to what happens in the case of a water supply circuit. In the case of water supply, what happens? From the water supply, water comes to the pump. Now at the pump, it creates a pressure difference. Due to this pressure difference that is created by the pump, the water is able to travel from the pump to the tank. Now the tank is usually placed at a higher level as compared to the pump. So the pressure difference that is created by the pump helps water to flow from the pump to the tank and then onwards from the tank to the home. So do you think that pump is actually creating the water? No. The pump is just creating a pressure difference which is helping water to flow in this water circuit. Similarly, the work of a battery is also not to create a charge. The work of the battery is to create or introduce a potential difference in the circuit, as a result of which charges in the circuit will flow and thus we get current. So as you can see in this simple circuit, introduction of a cell or a battery enables the bulb to glow because it introduces a potential difference which facilitates the movement of current. So how do you think a battery actually functions? What is the internal working mechanism in a battery? Now in this case, we will consider a galvanic cell. If you notice closely, in a galvanic cell, there are three parts: a positively charged cathode, an electrolyte, that is a chemical which is contained inside the battery, often in the liquid state, and a negatively charged anode over here. Now, it is important to note that in a galvanic cell, the cathode and anode are oppositely charged as compared to that what happens in the case of electrolysis. In electrolysis, the anode is positively charged and the cathode is negatively charged. So here we consider a galvanic cell where due to some chemical reaction in the electrolyte, charges have built up. These charges get accumulated on either side at the anode as well as the cathode. So at the anode, due to the chemical reaction, excess negative charges are accumulated. And at the cathode, due to the chemical reaction in the electrolyte, excess positive charges are accumulated. So this leads to the creation of a potential difference within the galvanic cell. So what do you think will happen if we connect this battery across a circuit? Because there exists a potential difference, the moment we complete a circuit with the help of this battery or cell, the electrons start flowing from the anode all the way around to the cathode. So the electrons are flowing from the region of low potential to the region of high potential. So when the electrons leave the anode and enter the cathode, certain reaction is taking place. So when the electrons are leaving the anode, this region is becoming deficient of negative charges. So oxidation is taking place at the anode. And at the cathode, the positive charges are getting gradually neutralized by the incoming negative charges. So at the cathode, reduction is taking place. So due to this oxidation reduction reaction that takes place at the anode and cathode, the battery or the cell is able to provide the circuit with charge or electricity. Now, as you can see, if this process is carried on for a long period of time, the negative charge at the anode gets depleted along with the positive charge at the cathode. So after a certain while, the useful life of this battery comes to an end. Now, there is also a very interesting classification which has been made on the basis of the useful life of a battery. Now, there are two kinds of cells which are currently in use. These cells are known as primary cells and secondary cells. So primary cell is a cell which I just told you about, which is of the use and throw kind. However, secondary cells are not of the use and throw kind. So let us find out how. In a primary cell or a galvanic cell, whose example I just gave, what happens is oxidation takes place at the anode and reduction takes place at the cathode. So as a result, electrons flow from the anode to the cathode. So the negative charges at the anode get reduced and the positive charges at the cathode get neutralized. So as a result, the negative charges are depleted at the anode and the positive charges are also depleted simultaneously at the cathode. So this leads to a reduction in the potential that the battery can supply or the cell can supply. So this means that after a certain period of operation, this cell will no longer be able to provide the circuit with potential difference. So that will be the end of the useful life of this cell. So such cells, which are of the use and throw type, are known as primary cells. Primary cells example can be found in the case of TV remotes or torches, where you usually find that after a certain period of time, you have to throw away the cells or the batteries because the reaction that takes place in the electrolyte no longer takes place. Because in the case of a primary cell, the reaction in the electrolyte is irreversible. That is, the oxidation reduction at the anode and cathode cannot be reversed. It is irreversible. So primary cells are of the use and throw type. Similarly, we have secondary cells which are not of the use and throw type. You must have seen that the batteries which your inverter uses at your home are recharged after a certain period of use. This recharging of the battery is done with the help of some external sources. So what do you think happens in a secondary battery? In a secondary battery or a secondary cell, the reaction that takes place in the electrolyte is reversible. That is, the anode and cathode oxidation and reduction process is reversible inside a secondary cell battery because the nature of the electrolyte is such. So in such a case, once the battery has been used up completely, you need not throw away the battery. It can simply be recharged and the battery will again go back to its previous state of being able to provide a potential difference. So secondary cells are not of the use and throw type. So here we see the basic differences between primary cells and secondary cells. As we saw, that primary cells have an irreversible chemical reaction occurring. This irreversible chemical reaction produces the current, and as a result of that, this primary cell is of the use and throw type. Similarly, secondary cells have reversible chemical reactions that take place in them. This reversible chemical reaction is responsible for producing the current. So because the reaction is reversible, secondary cells are of the rechargeable type. And as you can see, examples of primary cells and secondary cells have been given. This is a primary cell, a common type of cell that you use in TV remotes and torches. And this is the example of a secondary cell, a kind of cell or a battery that you use in cameras and other appliances.